Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fighting Back, Stan Andrews and the Birth of the Israeli Air Force, by Jeffrey Weiss and Craig Weiss, narrated by Barry Abrams. Prologue. Ashkelon is a quiet beach town, some 30 miles south of Tel Aviv. It became part of Israel on November 5, 1948, after the young nation's army succeeded in driving out Egyptian forces during what would become known as the War of Independence. The town grew slowly during the state's first decades. On its eastern, southern, and northern borders, there was only desert, a barren landscape that brought to mind the surface of the moon. Children who lived near the city's edge would play among the dunes. One spot in particular was a favorite site for their games. It was called Givat Hamatos, Airplane Hill. No one was sure why. Over the years, Ashkelon expanded, reclaiming more and more of the surrounding desert. In 1994, a work crew was operating along the edge of the town, near Givat Hamatos, preparing the area for yet another new neighborhood. Their bulldozer struck metal, something that looked like it might be from a plane, and the Air Force was called in to identify the remains. First on the scene was Amit Shrem, a young officer who had an idea about what had been uncovered. He thought it might be from an Israeli bomber that had crash-landed in the Negev more than 45 years earlier, during one of the climactic battles of the war. There wasn't much left to analyze. A section of wing, parts of a propeller, a portion of the engine cowlings, and other fragments, all long ago stripped clean either by the fire that burned for hours after the plane had ground to a halt in the sand, or the subsequent years of exposure to the unforgiving elements. Still, Amit knew what he was looking for, and what he found was enough to confirm his hunch about the plane's identity. Amit related all of this to Jeff in a phone call in 2009. Jeff was researching that plane, or, more to the point, one of the men who had been on it for its last mission. From the background noise, it was clear that Amit was in the car with one of his kids, but he did not mind the interruption. He described the events of that day in a straightforward, matter-of-fact tone. The phone call to the museum where he was then serving, his trip out to the construction site, and his verification of the plane's identity. But then, he shifted. There was one thing, he said, that was maftia and meragesh, surprising and moving. He told about the excavation of the section of wing. It otherwise had no paint on it, understandable from all it had been through. Yet, as Amit immediately saw, the IAF Jewish Star emblem was still there, somehow, impossibly, intact. Craig stood in the small apartment of Libby Anikstein, excited at the prospect of getting some answers to questions that he and Jeff had been struggling with for almost 10 years. After exchanging pleasantries, Libby handed Craig a letter written more than 60 years earlier, one that had outlived both the writer and the recipient. The letter was addressed to Irving Is Anikstein, Libby's husband, who had passed away within the last year. It was written by his brother Stan Andrews in April of 1948, only a few short weeks before Stan would travel to Palestine to join a skeleton air force as the local Jews prepared for independence and a certain invasion by the surrounding Arab nations. For nearly a decade, Craig and Jeff had longed to learn more about Stan. Perhaps foremost among their unanswered questions was why Stan had gone to Israel, a decision that was out of character with his entire life to that point. A few minutes earlier, Craig had asked Libby why she thought Stan had done it. "We don't have to wonder why he went. He told us," she had said as she handed him the letter. Craig began to read aloud to Libby and her daughter Narissa, the only other persons present. "This, in its own way, is going to be a very momentous letter, so I'd advise you to lean back and prepare yourself. I am leaving Los Angeles this Saturday, the 24th, and shall probably arrive in New York that night. After about 2 weeks there, spent in obtaining my passport, I shall proceed across to Europe and thence by various devious and melodramatic routes known only to a favored mysterious few, I go to Palestine. There I shall be engaged in my one-time and unlamented profession, flying combat. I don't think it's really necessary to tell you why I am going, aside from repeating that I don't believe in Zionism any more than you do. I can only say that I feel it's my fight as well as any other Jews, particularly after their betrayal by the U.S. Here is a thing that hundreds of thousands of Jews want, that by their suffering they have come to deserve, that is being attacked by fascists, and that can only be won by fighting, a thing at which I'm fairly adept. I think it's as clear-cut as that. But even if it were shadowed by other angles and facets of the situation, I would still go, because it represents to me one of the few chances that a Jew has to fight back against his tormentors and oppressors. Craig paused and considered the incongruity of a person about to embark on arguably the most extreme of Zionist actions, going to Israel to fight for a Jewish state, declaring a lack of belief in Zionism. Stan was, it was becoming clear, a person whose motivations defied easy explanation. The research journey had reached a critical milestone with the discovery of Stan's letter to his brother, and yet, at the same time, it was apparent that it was now only really beginning. Author's note. Why Stan? The Americans of Stan Andrews' era, those who lived their formative years during the Depression and went off to serve in World War II, have been referred to as the greatest generation. There is an analog to that, the greatest Jewish generation. They were the ones who witnessed the largest Jewish tragedy in modern history, the Holocaust, and its claiming of the lives of one-third of all of world Jewry, and who were part of the fight against the forces of evil who were responsible for it. They then took part in the greatest Jewish miracle in modern history, the dramatic birth of the State of Israel in a stirring military victory only 3 years later, ending 2,000 years of exile and putting to rest once and for all the reviled or pitied image of the wandering Jew. Stan epitomizes the members of this highly select group of no more than a few thousand, his experience as a microcosm of a larger Jewish drama playing out on the international stage, a play in three acts that began with apparent belonging and acceptance in the pre-war world, the shock of anti-Semitism in the war years, and the great Jewish return to Zion after the war. During our work on this book, we were often asked why we chose to write about Stan. Of course, writing about him meant much more than just putting words on a page. Over more than 20 years, it included locating as many people as we could who had been close to him, including a 93-year-old sister, an 85-year-old sister-in-law, former classmates, old friends, and squadron mates in World War II and Israel. It meant tracking down school yearbooks, a squadron memory book, high school and college essays, wartime letters, short stories written between wars, after-action reports from two wars, not to mention extensive archival research in both English and Hebrew. From our prior book on Americans in Israel's War of Independence, I Am My Brother's Keeper, we got to know many of the stories of the 1,000 or so North American volunteers. There were World War II aces, a member of the famed Black Sheep Squadron, the X-1 test pilot before Chuck Yeager, a former escapee from German captivity as a POW, the leading IAF aces of the War of Independence, the first commander of the Israel Navy, and Israel's first general. There were others who made a greater impact on the course of the war in Israel, some who had more glamorous records from World War II, and several who could lay claim to both things. To be sure, Stan's service in the Israeli Air Force, IAF, during the war was significant, impactful, and unique. He flew combat missions as a member of two different squadrons, the 1st Fighter Squadron and a Bomber Squadron. Between his service in those two squadrons, while holding the rank of major and using an assumed name, he worked with some of Israel's most senior military officials, including a future head of the Mossad, a future chief of staff, and a future prime minister. Stan, however, was a source of interest for reasons that went far beyond the details of his wartime service in Israel. He was a study in contrasts. In high school during the 1930s, like so many of his classmates at that time, he had been strongly anti-war. Yet, during World War II, he became a talented and aggressive bomber pilot who sought action. For the cause of a Jewish state, he volunteered to return to combat for a second time when other veterans were anxious to make up for the years lost during World War II and build their post-war lives. He had immense creative talent. He was both an artist and a writer. Stan's art included realistic and abstract works. He was equally comfortable with both, and everything from pencil sketches to oil paintings. Given the depth of his artistic talent, his passion for writing was a surprise. But he longed to be a writer, beginning in high school, from which he graduated at 16, and continuing through college, where he graduated at 19, World War II, and in the years that followed. His writing proved to be a powerful vehicle for exploring the issues that most moved him at different stages of his life. He was drawn to themes, whether it was the awkward teenage boy looking to find his way with girls, the atheist soldier confronting the possibility of death on the battlefield, the combat pilot losing his nerve, or the assimilated Jew struggling with anti-Semitism. A friend sizing him up in 1948 could have easily imagined him becoming a successful artist, an accomplished writer, or both. Stan's Judaism was also a study in contrast. He never once set foot in a synagogue before going to Israel, changed his name from the obviously Jewish Anikstein to the Gentile Andrews, was embarrassed about his Jewishness, once refusing to admit it to a World War II tentmate who was himself Jewish, and in 1948 was in a serious relationship with a non-Jewish woman whom he was poised to marry. Yet he was so aroused by the anti-Semitism of his day that he decided to risk everything to fight so that the Jews could have a state. He was in many ways the quintessential Zionist, but at the same time professed to not give a damn about Zionism. He was a source of admiration for those around him, yet he was, as John Hersey said of one of his characters in A Bell for Adorno, weak in certain attractive human ways. He was a ladies' man, but turned away from the wide-open carousing of post-war Los Angeles to embark on a committed relationship with a tender, thoughtful woman who was determined to marry him. He could be sarcastic in the face of unfairness and had a difficult-to-conceal contempt for those in positions of power, although at the same time was a devoted friend with a playful sense of humor, which he sometimes expressed in poetry. Stan epitomized the modern Jew of the years between World War I and World War II, assimilated, seemingly secure of his place in the modern world, aloof to the point of disdain from organized religious observance, and uninterested in the Zionist dream of restoring Jewish independence in Palestine. As it had for Theodor Herzl some 50 years earlier, anti-Semitism changed everything. While French response to the Dreyfus trial had been the catalyst for Herzl's journey to Zionism, for Stan it was the more mundane anti-Semitism of 1940s America. The little remarks that you can't poke a guy for, but have to smile and take or pretend you didn't hear, as he once described it to a friend. All of that reminded Stan that however much he thought he belonged in the America of his day, however much he had become convinced that his Jewishness did not define him, the people around him had a different view. All of this still remains relevant today. Albeit in ways less dramatic than for Stan, American Jews living in the 21st century still confront the issues that he wrestled with. To what extent are we defined by our Americanness, our Jewishness, or both? This question is particularly pointed in a country that is becoming more hostile to the outsider, more tribal, more anti-Semitic on the right, and more anti-Israel on the left. as we untangle issues of identity in America. Are we American Jews, Jewish Americans, or just Americans? There are other nagging questions that we cannot ignore and that bear fundamentally on how we see ourselves. What is our relationship to the State of Israel? And do we have obligations to our brothers and sisters there for whom the fight for a Jewish state continues? More than 70 years after Stan Andrews, artist, writer, and an assimilated and indifferent Jew, became one of the first fighter pilots in the history of the Israeli Air Force. Author's note on the use of Palestine and Palestinian. Until May 14, 1948, the area that today includes the State of Israel and the West Bank, the latter also referred to by some as Judea and Samaria, was collectively known as Palestine. The Romans coined the name in 135 AD following the crushing of a Jewish revolt led by Bar Kokhba, as the Jews headed into what would be a nearly 2,000-year exile from the land of Israel. There would not be an independent state of Palestine in the two millennia following the loss of Jewish independence, yet the name stuck. It seems surprising now, given the current political debate, but the word Palestine had an essentially Jewish connotation from the beginning of modern Zionism right up until David Ben-Gurion's Declaration of Independence on May 14, 1948. In The Jewish State, Zionist visionary Theodore Herzl wrote, "Palestine is our ever-memorable historic home. The very name of Palestine would attract our people with a force of marvelous potency." At the first Zionist conference in Basel, Switzerland in 1897, presided over by Herzl, the delegates passed a resolution announcing that Zionism seeks to establish a home for the Jewish people in Palestine secured under public law. In his declaration of 1917, Britain's Lord Balfour stated, "His Majesty's government view with favor the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people." The list goes on. Therefore, consistent with the practice of the time, we use Palestine in describing the site of events in what is today Israel that occurred during the period prior to May 14, 1948, and for events thereafter, use Israel. We use Palestinian to refer to the occupants of Palestine, whether Jewish or Arab, during this same period, and Israeli for residents of the State of Israel after independence. Chapter 1. Pretty Boy. You must remember that all my life I had heard of America. Everybody in our town had friends there, or was going there, or got money orders from there. The earliest game I played at was selling off my toy furniture and setting up in America. All my life America was waiting, beckoning, shining. The place where God would wipe away tears from off all faces. Israel Zangwill, The Melting Pot, 1908. In the spring of 1909, young Joseph Anikstein left Łódź, Russia for the long journey to America. He was a member of a mass Jewish exodus that, between 1881 and 1920, saw more than 1.5 million Russian Jews leave for new lives in the West. The roots of this large-scale emigration lay in the government's systematic persecution of its Jewish citizens. The Jews of Russia were a people apart. Since soon after Russia's late 18th-century partition of Poland, an overwhelming majority were confined to an area that became known as the Pale of Jewish Settlement. Jews were restricted in the professions they could pursue, the universities they could attend, and even their ability to teach the Russian language in their schools. These limitations trapped a substantial portion of the community in chronic poverty. At the end of the 19th century, some 40% of the Jews in the Pale were fully dependent on charity. Perhaps the most sinister policy subjected Jewish boys, sometimes as young as 8 or 9, to a hellish 25-year period of military service. That service was often undertaken at remote military canton schools, where soldiers were sometimes forcibly converted to Christianity, assuming they were even able to survive the physical rigors of army life at such an early age. Joseph had been a student at a higher-level Talmudic academy, open only to a particularly talented few. Among religious Jews like the Anneksteins, resistance to emigration was particularly high. They foresaw that life in America would be accompanied by a weakening of Jewish observance. They regarded the United States as a land where Jews would no longer keep the Sabbath, eat kosher food, or observe the many other rituals of religious life. But Joseph was not to be dissuaded. He had more immediate concerns than the vagaries of future religious observance. Like many Jewish boys of his age, he was no more than 17 when he left Russia, he feared being drafted into the Tsar's army. Further, after starting to work in a local garment shop, he had become part of an increasingly militant Jewish workers' movement. Strikes had led to crackdowns and arrests, and though Joseph had eluded imprisonment thus far, he realized that his luck could not hold out much longer. It was time to get out. Following the footsteps of many who had gone before him, Joseph crossed the Austro-Hungarian border illegally. From there, he traveled by train to Germany, to the port city of Bremen. Like the typical immigrant of his day, he traveled without his parents, whom he would not see again for years. In Bremen, Joseph found passage on the Friedrich der Große, Frederick the Great, a steamship that made the Atlantic crossing regularly. Joseph arrived at Ellis Island on May 5, 1909. Before long, he had found employment in New York's thriving garment industry, contributing to the production of ladies' blouses, known as shirt waists. The shirt waist business was thriving. Several years earlier, magazine illustrator Charles Dana Gibson had created the highly influential image of the Gibson girl, a modern, sophisticated woman who favored shirt waists and skirts. His creation sparked a fashion craze, and with it, an escalating demand for garment workers. By the beginning of the 20th century, between 150,000 and 200,000 Jews worked in the needle trades of New York. Conditions in the factories were bitterly difficult. Wages were low and the workdays long. The factory floor was crowded, and the employee-employer relationship was hostile. Workers were trailed to the bathroom and subjected to dignity-eroding searches before leaving the factory at day's end, lest they smuggle out a scrap of fabric. The term sweatshop was coined to describe the garment factories of Joseph's day, places where new immigrants were sweated to work longer and longer hours for less and less pay. Tuberculosis spread so easily among exhausted laborers in the cramped, poorly ventilated shops that it became known as the Jewish disease. The constant influx of young workers only made it easier for employers to resist calls for workplace reform. The difficult conditions radicalized many of the new immigrants. Among Jewish workers, there was already a strong inclination toward pro-union and pro-socialist activity, particularly for those who, like Joseph, had been involved in the struggle for workers' rights in Russia. For many Jews, the labor movement became a substitute for the ideals of the Torah and the Talmud. The spiritual commitment to pursuing justice and bettering the world evolved into a desire to improve workers' lives. Within a few years, Joseph met Rebecca Hoke, a fellow immigrant and garment worker. She had left Austria when her parents had tried to push her into an arranged marriage. Family lore held that there had been 40 generations of rabbis in the Hoke family, but the chain of strict Jewish observance ended with Rebecca. She was fiery and free-spirited, an atheist, and a committed socialist. After a brief, intense courtship, she and Joseph were married. Settling down in the Bronx, the two young immigrants had their first child, Esther, in 1912. A son was born 2 years later. For his name, Joseph took inspiration from Jewish philanthropist Isidore Strauss, who had perished with his wife during the sinking of the Titanic. He and Rebecca gave the boy the English name Irving and the Hebrew name Israel. In the family, Irving would always be Iz. For a decade, it seemed that this would be the entire Anakstein clan. But with Esther almost 12 and Iz 10, another Anakstein child unexpectedly arrived. On April 23, 1923, Rebecca gave birth to a second son, Stanley. To the older siblings, Stan was almost as much their child as he was Joseph's and Rebecca's. They looked out for him, doted on him, and helped him navigate the new world issues his parents did not understand. Despite the differences in age, the children grew remarkably close. The family was captivated by Stan's striking looks from a very young age. Rebecca could not resist entering one favorite photo of her son in a beautiful child contest after he was already a teenager. The photo won, mortifying the adolescent Stan, particularly when his friends started calling him Pretty Boy. Life in the Anakstein household proceeded with almost no formal religious observance of any kind. The family didn't attend synagogue even on the high holidays. Neither Iz nor Stan had a bar mitzvah. Yet Joseph remained fervent in his Jewish identity. When Iz and Esther decided to hang a stocking one Christmas for their little brother, their horrified father quickly tore it down. Socialist or not, there was a limit to the amount of assimilation he considered appropriate for the family. A joyous spirit prevailed in the close-knit home. Joseph had a dry sense of humor, a love of poetry, and a strong singing voice. Rebecca, who continued to work, doted on her boys. At one point, she became convinced that Iz wasn't growing fast enough, so she contacted a local healer who prescribed a treatment of fish oils. She later followed the same regimen with her younger son. Whether or not the result of this unconventional intervention, Stan's height shot up during his teenage years, setting him apart from his shorter classmates to such an extent that he felt awkward. By the time he was done growing, he was 6 feet tall. Before Stan turned 10, Esther introduced him to art. Though a talented artist herself, she soon realized that her younger brother showed far more promise. Stan, always with a pencil in his hand, could draw any image that caught his fancy. As he moved from sketching to oil painting, it was clear to anyone who saw his work that he was destined for a career in art. From his early school years, Stan was a presence. Even his walk made a statement of belonging. He was a precocious student, sometimes too much so for his dour teacher's liking. When Stan was in elementary school, an English teacher called his parents to complain about a classroom incident. The teacher explained that when she criticized something Stan had written, he had said, "If you take apart what an artist writes, you lose the quality of what an artist is trying to say." Esther, who had taken the call, commented that the statement was quite remarkable, coming from such a young boy. Offended by the lack of deference, the teacher retorted that, "The apple doesn't fall far from the tree," before hanging up in anger. Stan's bravado was no doubt a result of his strong academic success. He was skipped several times, finishing a junior high school program that included the ninth grade by the time he was 13. Under New York's open enrollment policy, Joseph and Rebecca had the option of sending Stan to any public high school in the five boroughs. They chose DeWitt Clinton, near the family's apartment in the Bronx. The faculty there was outstanding. A tight Depression-era job market meant many of the teachers had PhDs. Unlike many of New York's public high schools, Clinton was single-sex. With nearly 5,000 students, it was one of the largest all-boys secondary schools in the world. The Clinton environment was a nurturing one for a Jewish boy from the Bronx. While its students came from all over the city, most were from the neighborhood, a mix of Jews, Irish, and Italians, with a smattering of intrepid blacks from across the river in Harlem. Almost without exception, these students were a responsible lot. They went to class, did their homework in the library, and stayed out of trouble. Girls represented a special challenge to Stan early on, particularly given how young he was when he started at Clinton. Despite his good looks and outward confidence, He was awkward in his dealings with the opposite sex. It galled him that he was unable to initiate a conversation with one of the pretty Walton or Hunter girls that he would see on the subway. He often wondered if he would ever have his first sexual experience. It took a supreme effort to overcome his shyness, but he was determined. Eventually, Stan became a Sharpie, a young man who dressed nicely, danced well, and had an easy conversational manner with the girls. Upon finding his voice, there was no turning back. Once, Rebecca came home to find Stan in the apartment with a girl. Unsure what to do, she immediately called Esther. "You have to do something about that boy," she complained. The high school years were ones of great academic accomplishment for Stan. Clinton's student body was talented and highly motivated. Clubs and committees catered to nearly every academic and avocational interest. Stan took full advantage of these opportunities. He was the art editor for 3 different student journals, a member of the school's art squad, and was on the publicity committee, the last of which created the posters for school dances, allowing Stan to tend to his 2 great passions, art and girls. In the spring of 1939, he joined the art staff of the Magpie, the school's premier publication. The name had been inspired by a student in the 1920s who described it as a thing of shreds and tatters appropriate to magpies. Its intention was to be a serious literary offering, which, given the depth of talent at the school, was no pretense. One of Stan's co-contributors was Emil Capuya, whose literary career would include 6 years as editor of The Nation. Another, Richard Avedon, became one of the most renowned fashion and celebrity photographers of the 20th century. Stan Lieber Lee, the legendary comic writer and creator of Spider-Man, X-Men, The Fantastic Four, Hulk, Iron Man, and Thor, was yet another member of the journal staff. The students thrived on their intellectual camaraderie, spending hours together in the Magpie's offices discussing literature, politics, history, and religion. Like his older brother before him, Stan was a brilliant student. The work came easily, and he found that he could get A's with little studying. While the typical Clinton student spent several hours a night on homework, Stan devoted a fraction of that time. But whatever he did was enough. After graduating, he earned membership in Arista, the school's honor society. Only 1% of the seniors achieved that distinction. Stan's years at Clinton saw a great political evolution in the school and the United States as a whole. In the years after World War I, there was an increasing perception that American involvement had been a grave mistake, a view that 70% of Americans shared, according to a 1935 Gallup poll. In 1934, a committee headed by Senator Gerald P. Nye of North Dakota charged that Americans had been tricked into war by munitions makers. The accusation further fueled isolationist sentiment. For most of the 1930s, Clinton boys were strongly anti-war, in keeping with the national trend. Outside Clinton's walls, though, the world was becoming a more dangerous place. Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of Germany in January of 1933, and over the next 2 years, he consolidated his rule through the liquidation of political opponents and the dismantling of democratic institutions. In October 1935, Italy's Benito Mussolini sent his army into Ethiopia. A few months later, a civil war broke out in Spain, pitting fascist troops under the command of General Francisco Franco, backed by fascist Italy and Nazi Germany, against royalist forces supported by the Soviet Union and the International Communist Movement. The Japanese captured China's capital in 1937, unleashing a torrent of mayhem that became known as the Rape of Nanking. By Stan's senior year, the rise of the fascist powers and the fighting in Europe and Asia had begun to cause Americans to take notice of the dangers they could face, and student attitudes began to shift accordingly. The editor of the June 1939 Magpie wrote that, "In Northern Europe, a madman is running amok and the world awaits his next move." And in southern Europe and in the Far East, other less spectacular egomaniacs are mad for land and places in the sun. It would not be long before the pacifists and isolationists of the 1930s were being shipped all over the world to do their part in the greatest military conflict in human history. Young Stanley Anikstein of the Bronx, artist, honor student, pretty boy, and Sharpie, would be one of them. Chapter 2. The Poor Man's Harvard. I changed mine. Did you? Gentlemen's Agreement, 1947. In the summer of 1939, Stan graduated from Clinton. He had moved quickly through the ranks of New York's educational system and was only 16 as he prepared for his next academic challenge. Like the majority of his classmates, he decided to remain in New York. He enrolled at City College, more popularly known by its initials, CCNY. CCNY had a special place in the hearts of first-generation Jewish Americans like Stan, at a time when many of the country's finest educational institutions continued to openly discriminate against Jewish applicants. As late as 1945, the president of Dartmouth College could still boast that a quota for Jewish enrollment permitted the school to focus on the Christianization of its students. City College was a place where the Cohens, Levies, and Bernsteins knew their religious backgrounds would not hold them back. Equally important, the school was free, a major benefit for working-class families. For the Anicksteins, as for approximately 80% of their fellow Americans at the time, the price of 4 years of study at a private university was simply out of reach. CCNY, however, was hardly a school of last resort. It was one of the leading educational institutions of its day, producing 8 Nobel laureates in the 20th century, 3 who graduated while Stan was in high school and 2 who were students when he was there. One of Stan's friends was Leon Letterman, also of the class of 1943, who earned a Nobel Prize in Physics in 1988. CCNY fairly earned its nickname as the Harvard of the Poor. Before long, Stan's interests expanded beyond the world of art. Increasingly, he found himself attracted to writing. He had shown signs of promise at Clinton. A paper on the Grapes of Wrath had earned an A+, a feat that amazed his friends. In college, he worked to develop his talents further. When he looked to the future, he found that the dream of being an author was starting to crowd out his long-held vision of a life focused on art. At Clinton, Stan became good friends with Jerry Finley, another boy from the neighborhood. The two spent so much time at each other's apartments that they knew the precise number of steps to get from one to the other. They developed a ritual. When it was time for the visitor to return home, the host would accompany him precisely 1/2 the number of steps between their apartments before heading back. The young men remained close while Stan was at CCNY, where Jerry also attended classes for a time. Stan sketched Finley, something Stan was turning into a regular gesture of friendship. One day, late in 1942, Stan told Jerry that he was thinking of changing his last name. Stan did not explain why, and his friend, whose father had changed the family's name from Finkelstein to Finley, didn't ask for a reason. Jerry thought for a moment, then suggested Andrews. Some of Stan's motivation was practical. He thought that the name Anikstein was far too long and difficult to pronounce, and he tired of correcting people. But the desire to change his last name also reflected Stan's discomfort with its obviously Jewish connotation. He was not embarrassed at being Jewish, but it bothered him that it was the first thing people thought when they heard his name. Many others at CCNY were doing the same thing. Sauls were becoming Pauls, and Goldbergs were changing to Gilberts all around him. Typically in response to pervasive discrimination against Jews in the workplace and elsewhere in American society. Famous Jews of the day were also Americanizing their names. Jacob Julius Garfinkel, another child of immigrant tailors, had become the actor John Garfield. Emanuel Goldenberg, whose immigrant family had arrived at Ellis Island only a few years before Joseph Anikstein achieved fame as Edward G. Robinson. In explaining the change to his family, Stan pointed to his upcoming military service. Instead of waiting to be drafted, he had decided to volunteer for the Army Air Corps. Stan wanted to become a fighter pilot, and he worried that with a last name like Anikstein, he would be identified as a Jew and kept from pilot training. Joseph was upset with the decision and tried in vain to talk his son out of it. The name change would, in the end, have far-reaching consequences that neither father nor son could foresee. Stan's dream of flying fighters was shared by a great many young men in the early 1940s. Fighter pilots had first captured the public's imagination during World War I, with riveting tales of dogfights in the skies over Europe involving the likes of American Eddie Rickenbacker, who recorded 26 kills during the conflict, and German ace Baron von Richthofen, the Red Baron. Dashing in his leather jacket, silk scarf, and goggles, the man at the controls of a fighter plane was the envy of all men and, at least it seemed to the aspiring flyers, the desire of all women. Popular culture reflected all this. "He wears a pair of silver wings" was one of the most popular songs of 1942, telling of a woman's love for her pilot beau. "Why, I'm so full of pride when we go walking. Every time he's home on leave, he with those wings on his tunic and me with my heart on my sleeve." The idea that a pilot's wings could win over girls made all the sense in the world to Stan, who had spent many hours of his adolescence fantasizing about owning a car, which he was sure would guarantee him that elusive first sexual encounter. With his last name now legally changed to Andrews, Stan signed up at the end of 1942 for the Enlisted Reserve Corps and was told to report in the spring of 1943. With the impending departure of so many members of its senior class, CCNY accelerated the semester. By March, not yet 20 years old, Stan had finished his coursework. Excelling once again, he was one of 26 members of the graduating class elected to the prestigious Phi Beta Kappa Society. Despite the shortened term, the seniors still managed to put together a yearbook. As he had done with so many student publications at Clinton, Stan volunteered for the art staff. He worked hard as part of a bright and talented group that made the most of their last creative endeavor before heading off to war. More than half a century later, and having lost his vision, Marty Gold, one of Stan's collaborators, could still precisely describe the layout of the book from memory. The extent of Stan's contributions befitted his informal title as class artist. He prepared 9 woodcuts depicting the protectresses of the fine and liberal arts to introduce the different sections of the book. He also helped illustrate one of the major themes, coming events cast their shadow, with a pencil sketch of a soldier, sailor, and airman standing shoulder to shoulder, contrasted with a sketch of the same 3 in civilian clothes. There was no doubt where Stan saw himself in that tableau. The airman bears an unmistakable resemblance to the artist who drew him. As he headed off to the army, Stan was leaving behind the only city he had ever really known. Gone would be the familiar neighborhoods, schools where he had achieved great success and social acceptance, and a circle of close and admiring friends. Though he did not fully realize it, his time in New York had been comfortable and protected. The life of a soldier would not only expose him to the physical dangers of wartime service, but also, no less significant, to the loss of the protective social cocoon that had always been there for him. Chapter 3. An Air Force Man. The youth of America was under the spell of wings. Frederick Wakeman, Shore Leave, 1944. Stan's path to pilot's wings began with his strong suit, testing. At an Army reception center, he completed a series of mental and physical examinations that were designed to determine whether a cadet was best suited to be a pilot, navigator, or bombardier. When the results were posted, Stan found his name on the coveted pilot list. Then the training began. In little more than 2 months, the Army crammed students' heads with courses on the theory and practice of flight, physics, and Morse code, and tormented their bodies with long marches and other physical trials. All of it was meant to turn the men into officers and leaders, and standards were high. Guys were quickly washed out for poor performance or simply for having the wrong attitude. Stan crossed the Mason-Dixon line to continue his pilot training at an Army Air Forces base in Columbia, South Carolina. He started on a Stearman biplane, a single-engine aircraft he and the other cadets enjoyed flying. Still, the pressure to succeed was enormous. A cadet who failed to solo within 8 hours washed out. That meant the loss of the chance at pilot's wings and an uncertain fate as a navigator, bombardier, or even back into the enlisted ranks as a gunner. Stan soloed and continued through the gauntlet. Next came the BT-13 Volte Vibrator, and then the AT-6. Each new plane meant more complexity, and Stan and the other cadets didn't get comfortable until they had completed a few hours of flying. At each turn, with other cadets washing out all around them, the fear of failure was ever present. In more confident moments, Stan's thoughts turned to what lay ahead. Like most of the gung-ho recruits around him, all of whom had volunteered for pilot training.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.